Okay, hello everyone, and thank you for joining. In today's session, we're going to present here the new incremental backup feature in OGIRT. And the developers of this feature is Nir Sofer, Daniel Erez, and me, Eyal Shvinitsky. So let's take a deep breath and jump back to the future. The agenda for today, we will see the OGIRT old supported backup APIs. Then we'll go to the future and see the incremental backup APIs. Later, we're going to dive under the Lorien hood and see how we can use it using the engine backup APIs and IO backup APIs. And of course, we'll see some short demo at the end to see how it all works in real life. So let's start. Here is our OGIRT from 10,000 meters above. We have the OGIRT engine, the host. Of course, we have VMs and disks. And we have an external backup application that wants to backup the VMs and, of course, the disks on a storage that's dedicated for it. So how it's going to work? So in the past, let's go back in time. We have the backup appliance, the oldest backup solution. The year is 2014. Backup applications runs in a VM. How it's going to work? You take a snapshot of the VM, attach the disk snapshot to a backup VM, and inside the backup VM, you copy the entire disk. At the end, you detach the disk snapshot from the backup and delete the snapshot. Let's move a little bit closer to our time, image transfer API. The year is 2017. You're gonna use Image.io to download and upload snapshot using their Image.io REST API. It's available since 4.0. How it's gonna work? You just take a snapshot of the VM again, download the snapshot using QCO2 format, and delete all the snapshots. In order to upload and restore the VM, you prepare the disk on the backup application, upload the disk or the chain of snapshots raw in or QCO, and create a VM from the disk that uploaded to OGIRT. So let's jump to the future and see the incremental backup API. Neil?
Thank you, Eyal. So let's see the new incremental backup API. Next. So the new API is based on change block tracking and NBD protocol. It is still in tech preview in OGIRT 4.4. And it requires new SPVert and QMO, but currently in Relate, we have the required version of LiveRT and QMO. Next. So how do we do a backup in the new flow? We start a backup. We have a new API to start a backup. Then we download the disk. And when we download the disk, we get the raw disk, raw guest data, regardless of the actual disk format, and we stop the backup. You can see that it didn't have to do any snapshot. And how do you do incremental? Again, we start a backup using the new API, and we have a way to start an incremental backup. Then we download the disks, but now we can download only the change blocks. We don't have to download the entire disk. And again, we have access to the raw guest data. And we stop the backup. And again, no snapshots. Next. For restore, there is nothing really new. We prepare a disk for restore. This is something that the backup application should do. And then we upload the disk. But this time, we know how to upload a raw disk and write it into QCO2 disk if we need. We can convert the image format, the fly, and we attach a disk to a VM. Next. So what are the advantages of the new flow? First, we have support for copy change blocks. This speeds up incremental backup because we copy only the data that changed since the last backup. Next. We have the Extends API. This gives us a way to learn which data, which areas on the disk are data and zero, or which areas are changed or did not change since the last backup. Next. There are no snapshots. You don't have to create snapshot before the backup and delete snapshot after the backup. And we know that creating and deleting snapshots is very delicate process, and it can fail sometimes and cause a lot of trouble. So this is not needed now. Next. We have access to raw guest data, regardless of the actual disk format. When we backup a SIN disk or pre-located disk, we always get the raw guest data, and we can convert it to any format we need on the client side. Next. We have an imposed client. We have now an Image.io client library in Python that can upload and download raw or QKO images, including a backing file when we want to restore. Next. There are some limitations of the new APIs. First, we support incremental backup only for QKO 2 disks, because for all disks, we don't have anywhere to keep the metadata. Next. It's available only for running VM. We may enable it later for non-running VM. Next. And the access API is not useful for pre-located disks. Because in this case, you just get one extent of data. So it's only useful for QKO 2 disk or raw sparse disks on file system that reports sparseness. This is the basic limitation of storage. So now Eyal will dive under the hood to explain how everything works.
Okay, thank you, Nir. So let's go under the Lorian hood and see how it all works. So in the base of incremental backup, we have the new notion of checkpoints. So what are those checkpoints? You can think of a checkpoint as a lightweight snapshot, but checkpoints created by a libvirt. So when we are creating a backup for a VM, checkpoint is taken by libvirt for each backup that was taken. For example, backup was taken the January 1st, 2020. The name of the checkpoint is checkpoint number one, and the checkpoint includes two disks, and of course, it contains the backup that it's related to. So for every backup, the system creates a checkpoint that's recording the disks that's been backed up. So let's move forward in time. Day after, another backup was taken. Now the name of it is checkpoint number two, and that checkpoint has a parent that this was checkpoint number one. This checkpoint has also two disks, and we keep the parent checkpoint ID in it in creating a chain. Time goes by, another backup was taken, another checkpoint created, and now it's checkpoint number three. Again, it includes also two disks and related to backup number three. The engine persists those checkpoints in the database because libvirt only keeping those checkpoints as long as the VM is running on the host. When the VM will go down, the engine will need to redefine those checkpoints on the VM itself. So we are keeping it and the checkpoint XML on the engine database. But checkpoints are basically only metadata of the time or the disks that were included during the backup. In the what really tell us what which bits got changed or not. So in the base of that, we have the dirty bitmaps. So for each backup, we get a checkpoint on libvirt, but dirty bitmap is also created on QEMO. Each entry in the bitmap, as you can see here, this is the bitmap in blue, the checkpoint number one bitmap, is reflect and cluster on the disk, SDA disk. So as you can see here, since the backup was taken, the checkpoint was created and a bitmap is created also in QEMO. And you can see that no cluster got changed since the backup was taken. So everything is clean on the bitmap entries. Times go forward and we can see that data was changed in the second cluster. So the second bit on the dirty bitmap turned on. And remarks us that this cluster is now dirty and we need to be download it when we will want to backup that disk. Again, moving forward in time, we can see that the fourth and the fifth cluster changed also. We can see that even though that the fourth cluster is not fully changed, still marked as dirty. So another checkpoint was taken, another backup was taken, another checkpoint was created, and another bitmap created on the QEMO side. We can see that the first check bitmap is now deactivated. And since no changes was made to the disk since the second backup was taken, we can see that the dirty bitmap is still clean. Okay, so we have the dirty bitmaps. Now QEMO can specify if we want which cluster is dirty or not. As you can see, the first cluster that starts from offset zero and its length is, as you can see here, is marked as dirty false, while the second cluster is marked as dirty true. So it means that this cluster needs to be downloaded when the VM or the disk could be backed up. So now we know how it works using checkpoints and bitmaps on Libvirt and QEMO side. Let's see how we can really work with it using Ovid Backup API. So in order to start a full backup, this is the first step you need to do. You need to take a backup of the entire disks. How you can do that? First of all, we added the backup service. You can find it under a specific VM. You need to just add a new backup to that service and specify the disk that you want to include during this backup. As you can see here, we include only one disk in this example. So we have phases for the backup. We need to wait until the phase will be ready. And when the backup is ready, we will get the backup service. And from this service, we can fetch the created checkpoint ID. So as we said before, for each backup, we are creating a checkpoint and that checkpoint has ID. And we want to keep it in order to use it later for incremental backup and provide it to the engine. So the engine will know in the next backup that this is an incremental backup that starts from this specific checkpoint ID. After the backup was taken, we can start a transfer, an image transfer using the transfer service. We just specify the disk that we want to download, the direction of the download of the transfer, which is download. And for backup, we need to specify the backup ID and the format must be raw because we are transferring raw guest data. We'll wait until the backup, the transfer will be ready. And when the transfer is ready, we'll get the service. And inside that service, we can fetch the transfer URL and download the backup. More about this later. When we finish to download the backup, we can finalize the transfer and finalize the backup. Great, so we have a full backup in our backup application and how we can start an incremental backup. Again, the mechanism will be similar, but now we need to fetch only the disks that supports incremental backup. The user must specify which disk supports incremental backup and which disk will not support it. Of course, only QCO2 disks can support incremental backup. So the first step is to filter all the disks that supports incremental backup for the specific VM. Once we have them, we can start and add a new backup to the backup services, to the backup service, specify the disks, and now we will send the from checkpoint ID. From checkpoint ID marks us from which point of time we want to start an incremental backup to track the diffs. So if you remember, we kept the checkpoint ID that was created during the full backup. Now we pass it to the engine. Great. So this is how we can manage the engine API. Let's see how you can use Image.io backup API to download the backup. Neil?
Thank you, Em. So let's see how we get the data once we started the backup. We have a REST API, Image.io REST API. And the first thing in this API is the option request. When we connect to Image.io, when we got transfer URL from the image transfer API, and you want to download the data, the first thing that you want to do is send option request to the transfer URL. And let's see what we get in this request. We get JSON with list of features and information about the server that is we are going to need to backup or to restore images to this server. For example, this server supports the extends feature that we need during backup, and it supports the zero and flush feature that we need during restore. And we see that this server supports Unix socket. If we run the backup application on a hypervisor, which is the way to get the best performance, we can use the Unix socket to connect to ImageIO. So once we connected using HTTP and we got this information, we can close the connection and open another connection to using the Unix socket. And we can see the number of readers and writers that we can use. This can improve the backup throughput if you use multiple readers or multiple writers when we restore. Next. So how many gigabytes do we need to download? We have 100 gigabytes image and backup the image. How much gigabytes do we have to download? So we don't really know, but we have a way to tell. We have the Extends API. Next. So we send a GET request to the Extends resource. We add to the transfer URL. And we can specify the context. The default is zero. We can also specify it explicitly. And what do we get from this request? Next. Get a JSON response with a list of extents. For each extent, we have the start, offset, the length of the extents in bytes, and we get a flag if this extent is zero or data. Now, when we backup, we do a full backup, we want to ignore the areas which are zero. For example, the first extents is about 1 gigabyte. We can ignore this area. We don't need to download it from the server. And then we have a smaller extent, which is zero false, and we want to download this extent. This way we can get a huge speed up in the backup output. Next. Now, when we have incremental backup, we want to know which blocks have changed since the last backup. So how can we tell that? Again, using the Extends API. Next. This time we send, during the incremental backup, we send the extend request with context equal dirty. And this will tell us which errors are dirty and which errors are not. Next. So this time we got a response and we can see that the first extents is dirty. So we have 64K bytes that we want to download, the first extents. And the next extent, which is about 1 gigabyte, is not dirty. So in this case, we don't want to download this extent. We have to download only the dirty extents. And this again speeds up incremental backup, and we can see it in the demo later. Next. So we know which areas we want with extents. How do we get them? Well, this is very simple. We use the get method. Next. And we use the range header. This is a standard range request to request exactly the area we need. And in the response, we get exactly what we asked for. Next. So we need to send one get request per extent that we want to download. So now we have a backup and we want to restore it. How can we speed the restore in the same way? Again, we want to upload only the data. And in this case, we have extents on the backup that we want to put back in the storage. So we use the put method. Again, we can specify the range using the content line standard header. In this example, we are sending 128 megabytes to the server, and we want to write it in offset zero. Next. And the zeros, of course, how can we optimize the zero extents? We use the zero feature. Next. When we want to zero an area of storage, we can send a patch request using the patch method. And in this case, the payload is a small JSON object with the zero operation. And again, with offset and size, and this will zero this byte range on the server in the most efficient way without sending any data over the wire. Next. Finally, after we sent all the data, we are not done yet because before we finish the restore, we need to flush the data to storage. And we do this using the flush request. Next. It's like the zero method. We have a patch request with operation flush, and this will flush all data written to storage. When this returns, we know that we finished everything. So the only issue with this API is that it's a little complicated, and we have a better solution. Let's see it. Next. So we have the Image.io client library written in Python, and this is what the cool kids are using today. What you can do with the Image.io client library, you can write your own time machine in the easy way. So you can develop a backup solution using it. If you want to use the REST API, the lower level API, you can use it as a reference to understand how to use the API. And we use it for testing the backup API and for developing it. So how does the client work? We have the Python library, which the backup client will call. When you call the client library, we start a local QMNBD program. And this program will access the local image on the right side. And we communicate with this QMNBD program using NBD protocol, using the NBD client in Image.io client. And then we communicate with Image.io daemon using HTTP over the network. Or if we run on the hypervisor, we'll communicate with Image.io daemon using UniSocket for much faster transfer. And on the other side, we also have, during restore, we also have QMNBD connected to the remote image. And again, we communicate with it using NBD protocol. And during a backup, we will have on the other side QMO. Next. So this is an example of how they use the Image.io client. We import it. And then we call the client download method. And we pass the transfer URL and then pass to the local image we want to download to. And this will download, get all the extents in the image, and then download only the data extents, keeping the zero extents. It will use UniSocket if needed, and it will use also multiple connections if the server supports it, and it will store the data in Kubectl format. That's all in one call. Next. And the same for incremental backup. We use the same client, the same download function, but this time we'll specify incremental equal to, and this will download, get the dirty extents, download them, again, with all the optimizations and save the data in Kubectl format. Next. So this is the example of what we get from the From the backup, full backup and incremental backup, it goes to images. And of course, we control the name, so we can control how it looks like. And when we want to restore a chain of images, what we have to do is first to create a chain from the separate images from the backup. So in this example, we had one full backup. In the bottom of the slide, we have full backup from 12 in January. And we had another backup in the 13 and another backup in the 14. So what we do is use QMMG rebase to create a chain from the backups. We rebase the last backup, last incremental backup on top of the one before it. And then we rebase the next incremental backup on top of the full backup. And now we have a chain of images. And this change can be used to start a VM or to upload all the data to the host. In this case, we use the ImageIO client. This time, we use the upload function. We give it the transfer URL for an upload and the top image in the chain. And this will upload all the data from the entire chain and zero all the errors on storage that are not included in this backup. And on the other side, we will get complete image in any format we need, depending on the type of the disk that we created. And we actually completed the restore. So next, we'll see the demo. Eyal, please.
Okay, thank you, Nir. So let's move fast to the demo. So as you can see here, we have a VM that we want to backup. We have a disk for that VM. We enable the incremental backup for it. We will use an SDK example that we also provided in order to facilitate the use of incremental backup. So it's called backup VM. We use the start method for this script, and it starts a backup for us. This will be a full backup. We just see in the host that we have a Unix socket and we have everything that we need to download the backup. We can see the backup was created on the database in VM backups and VM backups disks map. And we can start, the backup is ready and we can start download it. Okay, in the guest itself, we are adding a directory. This directory added after the backup was taken, so we are not expecting to see it on the backup that we are downloading after it was taken. Good, so we now can use the same script, but now we'll use the download method, download the backup that was created by specifying the VM ID and the backup ID. Okay. So since this is a full backup, this was done over the wire, so it would be quite slow. We can see that it created for us an image transfer. Image transfer is ready. We got the transfer URL and the backup downloaded to our backup application, in this case, a local directory. This is the directory that the backup was downloaded to it. This is a full backup. So we are now want to create a VM from it to see what's in it. So we just create another layer of Kubeflow layer on top of it, just to keep the data and not corrupt any information there. We're creating a Kubeflow layer on top of it, and we can start a VM from it. We now expect to see a clean VM. Without the directory that was created after the backup was taken. Okay, as you can see, there are no directories. So the backup actually tells us that this is the state of the VM that was while the backup was taken. Okay, so now I want to take a full incremental backup. Now we'll stop the full backup first using the VM ID and the backup ID. Okay, backup is finalized. We can see on the host that runs the VM, there is no Unix socket, there is no transient disk, and all backups entities removed from the database. Now we want to run to start an incremental backup. So we'll use the incremental verb of the script that was created for you, the backupvm.py. This verb will start an incremental backup from a specific checkpoint ID that was created during the full backup. As you can see, it will start an incremental backup, download it to the given path, and finalize the backup. Okay, since this is an incremental backup, it was really fast. Backup was started, image transfer was created, and downloaded to the local directory. You can see here that now we have full backup and an incremental backup. So we will rebase the incremental backup on top of the full backup and create another Kubeflow layer, start the VM from it. And we are starting the VM. Now we expect to see the directory that was created after the full backup was taken. And the directory is there. So incremental backup succeeded. Great. So this was the demo. We are a little bit out of time. So we have here more links for you if you want to see another more information about this feature. And that will be all. Thank you, everyone, and hope you enjoy it. Thank you, Nir. Bye-bye.